The next film I made in the States was called, finally, The Great Bank Hoax, although it's known under a number of other names as well, like The Great Georgia Bank Hoax and so on. Anyway, that was made in Georgia, in deepest Georgia, and had a very nice cast with Richard Basehart and Burgess Meredith and Paul Sand. And the couple of girls were less known, but the men were very well known. And I'll think of them in a minute, it doesn't matter. And anyway, so we were shooting in Madison, Georgia, which is a model town. People go to Madison, Georgia to see all the colonial homes there, the old colonial homes there. But there isn't much in the way of accommodation. There's one motel, which we ended up in, which was either Howard Johnson's or Holiday Inn, one of those. And you could either eat there or you could eat in the local tavern. There was a local one place, which had been desegregated some years previously when desegregation happened. But it was still in effect segregated. There was a front room and a back room, and no black guy would have dared sit in the front room. It was exactly like it was before, only officially it was desegregated. And that film was, I sort of wondered, on most films you get to know sooner or later, usually up front, who is actually putting up the money for this film. But in this particular case, there wasn't any kind of presence of the front office. It was totally lacking. And the director was called Joe Jacoby, and he'd also written the script, and he'd made one film previously called, I believe, Hurry Up or You'll Be 40, something like that. And he was very good. He was a very good director, very efficient, and the script was very good. It was about a bank, a little rural bank in deepest Georgia, where they discover a discrepancy in the books just before an audit is due. And one of the bank clerks confesses to having made a scheme where he could siphon off the money gradually from various accounts all the time and put them in his own account. But he hadn't done it he didn't actually want the money, he just wanted to see if it could be done. Unfortunately, the timing of it was such that between the discovery of the fraud and the due arrival of the bank inspectors, he hadn't yet confessed. So the bank directors devised a scheme to cover up this deficiency, this discrepancy, by staging a raid on their own bank, a bank robbery, which they did. And it's very funny, they arrive on a tandem bicycle in the middle of the night. You know? Very funny scenes. And then he confesses, and then they have the money twice, which is a problem again, because they've just announced to the insurers that there's been a robbery and such and such an amount is missing, and then he gives the money back, so they've actually got twice the money. They've got the money that they took from the vault, and they've got the money that he's prepared to give back them. So he says, this is something we'll have to think about, all this.
The movie wasn't released.
And no, that movie, to my best knowledge, it was never released. But it exists in the on the internet as under various titles. Perhaps it had a very small release somewhere, but I'm not aware of it having been released. And that's why I haven't got it on cassette either, because I couldn't find it. But we filmed for some 7 weeks in this little Georgia town, and there was one scene where we filmed in a bank in Atlanta. During which I discovered that the first National Bank of Atlanta, Georgia, and the first National Bank of Madison, Georgia, have no connection whatsoever. I thought one would be a branch of the other, like one might expect, but it wasn't. So when I asked the Bank of Madison, Georgia, the first National Bank of Madison, Georgia, to transfer some of my salary to England, they said, "Oh, I've never done anything like that before." And so I had the cash. I was given a check, and it could only be cashed in that bank because it was drawn on that bank. And so I had to cash the money, and I said, "Oh, I'll find a way of sending it." And then I said, "Well, at least can I have this money in 50s?" And they said, "Oh no, we don't have any 50s. We only have 20s." He said, "Because there's no call for 50s here." It also had, that place also had a very interesting liquor store, which I found quite common in America, where they had these giant Jeroboams of wine and beer in enormous quantities. But to get a small bottle was quite difficult. And there was a moment when the waitress in the Howard Johnson's or the Holiday Inn or whatever it was came to us one day, and having served us for several weeks and seeing that we were all British, she sort of said, "Do you know, you're not like us, you know?" And I said, "Why not?" And she thought a bit, and then she said, "Well, you don't eat grits." That was the first point. Well, the food was a bit monotonous because it was only that place or the desegregated tavern. So it was a bit sparse. So the choice wasn't exactly brilliant. But the movie's not bad. It I don't know why it never made it. But again, it was one of those independent movies. Oh, yes, the finance. It turned out, finally, the reason there wasn't the presence of a front office was that the money had been put up by some porno king. He was a porno movie king who was at present in jail. That's why there was never a producer on the set.